So welcome everyone, thanks for hanging on. I know I'm one of the last to present. Hope all of this has been really beneficial and useful. We've had a couple of questions that pulled from the Q&A session, so hopefully we'll cover those in our presentation. But one of them I just want to touch on briefly was about if I haven't finished my engineering degree and I'm considering joining the Royal Air Force, is there still an opportunity for me? In short, yes, there is. I'll fill out more details as we go along. But we have apprenticeships and we also have learning credits that people can use to do their degrees. So you could use the credits that you've got now and finish off your degree later if you so choose to. So initially, I'm just going to talk a little bit about my career. So I joined the Royal Air Force in November 2009, just after I finished at Loughborough University doing a Master's in Systems Engineering. Top left picture is me and my dad at my graduation. I've had nearly 11 years doing a whole range of different jobs. I've got dogs that come to work with me in the top picture. I've played professional rugby at Premiership Standard for Bristol and for the Royal Air Force and gone on tours to South Africa and America. Got some flying in helicopters and get to have a few socials with some of my team. So what's my career to date? So initially joined in November, I did 9 months of initial officer training that teaches us everything that we need to do to be in the Royal Air Force and to be an officer. We then continue with another 9 months of engineer officer training. This gets us ready for our engineering degree specified jobs. As I said, I've done a range of jobs and there's 175 different jobs for communication engineers in the Air Force at my rank. No one job is the same. So my degree storyline timeline would be completely different to somebody else's. I was fortunate enough to go to a deployed station in my initial job called the One Air Control Centre, working with deployable radar, as you see in the bottom picture, and deploying on Op Olympics or the Olympics in 2012 to do a recognised air picture, which is basically what's in the sky for the typhoons whilst they were supporting the Olympics. I then moved and took my skills that I'd learned from the radar to go and deploy to the Falklands for 6 months, where I looked after 45 different people of different skill sets, both catering, medical, engineering, and the main focus was looking after those people and the dispersal from being away from their family for that long. I then moved to the duty ops team in Corsham, where I'm currently based now as well. That was a 24/7 shift work where I'm reacting to incidents and events that are happening on the defence network. I then took a completely different role 2 years later to work with RAF Typhoon project team. My responsibility was a £4 million contract to upgrade the software systems that support the Typhoon. Incredibly challenging and rewarding job that was a full hardware and software upgrade, which is a good challenge. Before my current job, my last job was what we call an OCC4I, quite a typical comms engineering job. Again, mostly worried about looking after the 50 odd people that work for me and all the communications, whether that's IT, radar, and other systems that help a station run. My current job is quite difficult to explain. I currently do mission support in J3 operations in Corsham. Our main focus there is defence of cyber and network operations. So we look after all of defence's networks, and part of my role is a very empowered role where I manage risk management and support to all the operations within that 400 person area. So now I'm going to talk a bit about how the career goes and how sponsorship opportunities there are in the Royal Air Force and sort of what the next stage is for you if you were interested in joining. So what's the role of the Royal Air Force? Our role is to protect the UK and her interests 24/7, whether that's through support to civilian authorities, such as the pandemic, or the local police forces through the COVID pandemic. We also provide the nation with the choice in times of crisis. So we deal with quick reaction alerts to airspace invasion from other aircraft and multiple operations throughout the world. We're approximately 33,000 people in the RAF. Coming back to the diversity question earlier, we're actually 18% female, but obviously some of those trades aren't STEM related, so that's why possibly our number is a little bit higher. We are aiming for 20% by the end of this year and are on target. Of that, there's 12,000 of us are engineers and engineer technicians, looking after the cutting edge of defence capabilities in both cyber and space domains and the air domain in generating aircraft. The most important people, therefore, the most important thing about the Air Force is our people. With 33,000 people on the books, we can't do our job without having and looking after those people. So, as I said, I'm an engineering officer. There are other roles where you're non-commissioned. Officers lean towards the leaders and managers of our people. As I said, I've looked after 50 people in a team. And my degree from Loughborough University had human factors and organisational behaviour that really helped bring out my leadership and management capabilities. Some of the things that we look for in an officer, and I'll touch on a couple of things just to give you some examples. So emotional intelligence, the ability to notice someone's a little bit stressed, really difficult in a virtual environment these days. You can't pick up on the same behaviour and actions on people. But noticing the other day, for example, one of my corporals, she was very stressed and taking some time to talk to her, make it realise that there's something going on at home that's impacting her at work. So, and dealing with that situation, taking the stresses off her, supporting her so that she could get on, look after her home life, and then come back to work when she was ready. Able to manage ambiguity is a big factor at the moment in my job. I often get a task which is, could you write the framework for this new organisation that we want to set up? And I'll have to write an 8-page document on what we think that framework should look like. So being able to understand what the commander's intent or the boss's intent is and relaying that into a useful piece of staff work. Mentally agile and physically robust. So the pandemic is a really good example of that. I'm actually the business continuity planner for Caution where I work. As I said, responsible for 400 people. Being agile enough to adapt, to change the situation and the scenario. Where we work, we can't just evacuate the building. We had to maintain 24/7 operations, but making sure that we could COVID secure that building and look after our staff was primarily my responsibility. So being able to be robust in the decisions I make when it makes things difficult for our executives and being agile enough to support our people was an important trait that I needed in that situation. So as I said, I'm an engineer. There are a multitude of different officer roles and, as I said, non-commissioned posts as well, ranging from being a pilot, a lawyer, a nursing officer, and a vast amount. So if you're not quite sure that engineering officer is floating your boat, there's definitely lots of different opportunities that I encourage you to go and look at and find out some information on. As it's a STEM event and we're talking about women in technology, I am going to pick up on engineering officer and what our process is. So I mentioned earlier in the Q&A session that we have communications and electronics engineers and aerosystems engineers. Aerosystems engineers do pretty much everything that it says. They look after all the aircraft and anything supporting an aircraft. Communications engineers, however, do everything else. Obviously, I'm a bit biased because I'm a communications engineer, but I did apply for Aero and I don't regret the decision that I made to become a communications engineer. We are a growing trade. Cyber has had a huge investment in defence from the government, and the roles in which are getting into cyber are growing by the day. So I talked about lots of different jobs and I've talked about deployments. Where can you actually get employed? We all think about virtual work at the moment, but actually there's lots of different opportunities to move all over the UK, which this map is just demonstrating here. In the last talk with Sophie, there was a discussion about whether you got social support. If you join the Royal Air Force, you'll get given accommodation at a very reduced rate, very much like university. It was a great stepping stone that I took. You went into the mess, you're surrounded by your peers, you're supported, you're fed, everything's there. We've got a network like university for every sport and interest that you've got. We've got a club for it. So coming back to the two types of engineers, what do you need to do to become either a communications engineer or an AS engineer? So a recognised degree, we all talk about masters or bachelors in engineering, but there are some other degrees that are recognised, and I suggest you reach out to your careers office to get information. But things like cyber science, mathematics can be recognised degrees that you can join as an engineer officer. Engineer officer and doctors are one of the two officer roles that have to have a degree. So there are other roles that you don't have to have a degree in. We are paid in kind for that requirement. So whilst you could join as a per support role or weapon systems officer with a degree, you won't get the same pay spine as you would as an engineer because you have to have a degree to be an engineering officer. There are a vast amount of routes for sponsorship. So you can join the Defence Technical Undergraduate Scheme through university, who will sponsor you through university. There is a requirement to do approximately 30 days return of service, which is different things during the weekends and one night a week, getting together with like-minded peers. So it's more of a social element too. There's the University Air Squadron, who do some sponsorships, but not a full Defence Technical Undergraduate bursary. I joined the University Air Squadron when I was at Loughborough, and there was a Defence Technical Undergraduate scheme there too. University Air Squadron was great because there was a range of different trades that were in the University Air Squadron, so we got to learn a lot through that, and I got to do some flying, which I really enjoyed. There is also A-level sponsorships and apprenticeships, as we said before, if you don't want to go the engineer officer route. And once you're in, there's also learning credits that you get throughout your career. Every year you'll get a amount of credit that you can use to enhance your education. If, however, you do go the engineering route, when you do your engineering training, we offer you a master's degree that you can do through Lincoln University. And we pay for your professional accreditation through IET or IMEC, or the Royal Aeronautical Association. You can also apply for your IEng and CEng status, and you can get paid for that. So if you apply for your IEng, you'll get £3,000, and if you apply for your CEng, you'll get £5,000. It is taxable, but it's an extra bonus that you get just for gaining your incorporated engineer status, which I think we all agree as engineers is something we strive to achieve. And as I said, our fees for professional accreditation are paid for. So I've talked about recruiting and joining. Let's take a bit of a closer look on the training side. All sounds a bit scary to go off and do 9 months of training. So how do I actually join? You'd go to what we call Officer and Aircrew Selection Centre. As I said, there's a couple of virtual elements now that have been put in during COVID. But ultimately, it's a one-day event where you get an aptitude test that just demonstrates your different skill sets. You'll do some group discussions. You'll do some leadership challenges. It is all meant to be fun, and it actually is good fun, although there's the pressure of wanting the job. It's all about just demonstrating you and how you problem solve. Engineers have got a really good advantage to this because the way our brains work tend to lean us nicely into OASE when we apply for it. So if you get selected at OASC, you would start IoT at Cranwell. It's now reduced to a 6-month course. It teaches you all the skills that's required to be an officer in the Royal Air Force. You'll train alongside all the other branches that I talked about earlier. It will get you ready for your next part phase training, which is your engineer officer training at Cosford. Cosford training takes, again, 6 months. You'll learn about all the different roles as an engineer, and you'll work alongside some of the non-commissioned trainees as well. So to summarise the route, careers office, a couple of virtual events first, OASC for a day at Cranwell, where you'll go through a selection programme, much like every other employer does, IoT for 6 months, engineer training for 6 months, and then you're into your first job. Sounds like a long time, but it actually isn't. And in that time, you're still learning. I've been to university. How does the real, how does a real job work? How am I evolving and moving around and getting to know all these people? What's expected of me? And all of a sudden, you're in charge and responsible for some people. Really fun and exciting time, and that time does go quickly. But the journey doesn't end there. We're constantly working on professional development. There's intermediate officer training throughout your career that you touch on every 18 months, and professional qualifications as you go along. But what we really want to know, whilst we all live in this virtual pandemic world, is what our lifestyle is all about.
There is opportunities to stay in roles longer than that. It can be difficult to move around so often. I think when I first joined, it was definitely a matter of excitement. I could be posted anywhere around the world.
I find it really important to have that balance of friends away from the Royal Air Force. At the same time, I love getting involved with what the RAF does. I like to have a good balance.
The work-life balance is what you make it. I had my daughter, but I actually think I've become more effective at using my time, so it doesn't matter as much because I still do my core hours and they are very flexible. I've got my laptop, I can work from home.
Living in mess is sort of a shared living environment. You get your own room, you get your own bathrooms normally, but the best bit about the mess is probably the bar.
The mess is there for anyone to use, but you don't have to use it. I know a lot of friends of mine who perhaps have family who actually own a property elsewhere will do the commute day to day, or in fact live in the mess in the week and then go back to their own home in the weekend.
Sports is quite a big one for me. I currently play RAF hockey for the under 25s. I'm involved in other aspects such as tennis, athletics, skiing. It provides all those opportunities that you wouldn't get in a normal job.
Well, it's important that you keep fit for your job. I think it helps create a unit identity or flight identity. It's just good for morale.
Okay, cool. I'll try and squeeze those in. Just a couple of last slides. So that just gave you an insight to some of the lifestyle. As I said before, I've done rugby. I've gone on 5 different expeds around the world for different events like dog sledding, skiing, rugby tours, canoeing expeds. Absolutely loved every minute of it. But we are flexible to your situation. So I'll just leave you with our last video about engineering as an officer in the Royal Air Force, and then we'll come to our questions.
a youngster growing up, aircraft always fascinated me. And I'm now at a stage where I'm working with some of the most advanced aircraft we have. To know that you're working on something so advanced is fantastic.
The most interesting part about the job is just the variety of things I'm involved in.
You're learning new things all the time.
There are so many different roles and responsibilities.
You get a lot of responsibility very quickly.
But also just being so operationally focused, that was the main thing for me. I like deploying, I like being away.
What I enjoy most is the people that I work with.
That's my favourite bit. We have a good laugh.
Massive amounts of social opportunities and sport as well.
If I had to give any advice to somebody who's coming into the RAF now, I'd say just embrace it, take every opportunity you've got and just enjoy it.
If it's something that you really want to do and if it's something you're going to enjoy, then it's something you're going to be good at. What better opportunity is there than something that gives you such a variety and can motivate you every day?
It's the people I work with, the travel that I get to do, and the interest and unusual scenarios that I get put in with my job.